Bantam Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents Starfist, Book 2, School of Fire, by David Sherman and Dan Cragg. Read for you by John Bedford Lloyd. The approaching sounds of snapping twigs and wet fronds squelching under rushing feet came to Commander Hing's ears. He didn't turn to look toward their source. If it was some fool of a felt Polizei trooper coming through the forest, the man wouldn't live long enough to reach his position, except as a prisoner. His fighters would see to that. Most likely, Hing thought, it was one of his guerrilla band scouts returning with a hoped-for report of a small felt Polizei patrol approaching the ambush site. The sounds came closer and closer and finally stopped, punctuated by the thump of a knee hitting the ground, a meter from where Hing lay concealed in a clump of gross palms.
"Commander, it must be true what we have heard. The felt Polizei has a new commissioner," a gasping voice said.
Hing turned his attention from the road and looked at the speaker, Fighter Quetlal, the scout whose hasty approach had snapped so many twigs, squelched so many fronds. The commander raised an eyebrow questioningly. Quetlal was grinning broadly.
"They are not wearing camouflage, Commander. They are not even wearing plain green or tan to help them hide among the trees."
His grin broadened and his eyes glittered.
"There are 100 of them, and they are all wearing orange tunics and sky blue pantaloons. You can tell the officers by the plumes on their helmets."
Hing slowly shook his head one time. The oligarchs were getting more and more foolish in their conduct of this war. Where had they gotten the idea that sharp-looking parade ground troops made the best fighters? Did they really think fancy uniforms would frighten fighting men? "How long?"
"As they are marching down the middle of the road, I must say bare minutes."
"How watchful are they?"
"Their eyes are straight ahead as though they are passing in review. They are even carrying their masters at right shoulder arms."
"Scouts? Flankers?"
Fighter Quetlal shook his head. "They have 2 point men 20 meters ahead of the column. That is all of their security."
"Have you passed an alert?"
"As I came along our line, Commander, I told everybody."
"Then continue along our line and tell the rest of the company." Hing turned back to the road. Quetlal was dismissed. Commander Hing's fingers absently caressed the stock of his blaster, fondled its firing lever. His was one of the few modern weapons possessed by the grandiosely named Chi Loi Brigade of the People's Liberation Army, and the only one in this ambush. The rest of the 60 brigade members with him were armed with obsolete projectile rifles, which was a major reason for this ambush, to take modern weapons from the corpses of the oligarchy's felt Polizei. Soon, in bare minutes, Hing's fighters would strike a mighty blow and strike further fear into the hearts of the oligarchy and become better armed.
"That imbecile sends us to our death," Patrolman Perez muttered to the man at his side.
"Only if they lie in ambush," Patrolman Trong replied equally quietly, "and are not frightened off by our blasters."
He wanted to spit, but Captain Rickdorf's discipline was too severe for him to take the chance. Fighter Quetlal had barely left Commander Hing's position when the brigade leader heard the slightly ragged tramp, tramp, tramp of marching feet coming along the road below. Two troopers, as splendidly popinjayed as Fighter Quetlal had promised, strutted into sight. Sunlight filtering through the tops of the towering hawkbaum trees that grew between the clumps of gross palms dappled their tunics to the flowing color of old gold. Their marching legs swish-swishing along made their sky-blue trousers ripple like fast-flowing water in a clear, shallow stream.
"Fools," he muttered, dismissing them.
But his eyes lingered hungrily on their weapons. Soon the fighters of his brigade would put those modern weapons to far better use than these comic opera felt Polizei ever could. 20 meters behind the point men, the rest of the column snaked along the road, marching 2 men abreast.
This was so foolish.
Hing suspected their commander would have had them marching 3 or 4 abreast had the road been wide enough.
Their commander, oh yes.
He was the most glorious popinjay of them all. His tunic was piped with gold cord. Gold epaulets jounced on his shoulders.
a forager, a braided gold cord, swirled around and dangled from his shoulder. A veritable kaleidoscope of metals adorned his left breast. The saber he carried, point up against his shoulder, looked like a purely ceremonial blade, not a fighting blade at all. As though a sword was a weapon to use against blasters or even projectile weapons. He encountered the ranks of felt polizei as they marched past him. When his count reached 22, he put his whistle to his lips. At 23, he sucked his chest full of air. At 24, near the center of the double line of felt polizei, when all were well within the killing zone of the ambush, he blew. Thunder rippled all along the hillside as the fighters of the Chi Loi Brigade opened fire at the marching column. Here an orange-tuniced man thudded screaming to the ground, clutching his thigh where arterial blood pulsed brightly from a bullet hole. There another spun about, his shattered arm spraying red. A brilliant rosette of bone and brain and blood blossomed on the forehead of a third man before he collapsed. Others staggered from the bullets that thudded into their bodies, but kept their feet as their body armor spread and absorbed the kinetic energy of the blows.
"Troop, face to the right!"
Captain Rickdorf and his platoon officers shouted above the din of gunfire. Crackling plasma flashed from the nozzles of the front rank's blasters and struck the hillside in a random pattern, followed quickly by an equally random pattern from the blasters of the rear rank. There were one or two screams from guerrillas charred by bolts, but the screams were quickly cut off by death or shock. Here and there along the two lines of felt polizei, men staggered or bent as bullets spent their energy against their armor. A few screamed in agony from the pain of bullets that tore into arms or legs. Their screams were not matched from the hillside. Only a few troopers fell from chance hits in their heads. Commander Hing saw how the troopers reacted to the body blows of his men's bullets and understood almost immediately why they remained standing and continued to fire. Maybe he should have let them pass, but maybe he and his guerrillas could still win the fight. "They're wearing body armor," he shouted. "Aim for heads, arms, legs." Elsewhere along the ambush line, he heard others cry out the same order, some so quickly he knew he wasn't the only one to see and know. The guerrillas shifted their aim from the center of their targets to the extremities, and troopers started falling. The felt polizei stood or knelt in patient ranks for the space of one more volley, before individuals among them began to notice, above the crackles of blasters and bangs of rifles, screaming from within their own ranks and a lessening of their plasma cracks.
"I told you,"
Perez shrilled at Trong.
"Keep firing," Trong shouted back.
Terror rapidly mounted in his heart, and Perez glanced to the side. If anyone broke ranks, he would run with them. He looped just in time to see Shift Sergeant Ruiz's face erupt and splatter blood and brain from two bullet hits. Perez shrieked in horror and panic at the sight. He dropped his blaster and ran. Captain Rickdorf, head held high, swept his gaze across the hillside. The bandits must be higher on the hillside than he guessed. Their fire wasn't slackening.
"Rear rank, leapfrog 10.
He never finished the command. Simultaneously, one bullet tore through his throat, a second shattered his right temple, and a third shot between his open lips and ripped out the joint that held his skull to his neck bones. From the hillside, the guerrillas saw the troopers falling now and cheered. On the road, more and more of the troopers heard and saw the men to their sides no longer firing, either down or breaking ranks. Abruptly, the surviving felt polizei who were able ran.
"Get them," Commander Hing screamed. "Kill them before they get away."
The guerrillas rained fire at the fleeing felt polizei, most of whom had thrown away their weapons to speed their flight. Many of them fell, dead from headshots or crippled with shattered legs. Some dropped to their knees and faced the hillside with their arms upraised in surrender.
"Cease fire! Cease fire!"
Hing shouted as he bounded down the hill. On all sides, his fighters came with him. Commander Hing looked up and down along the road between the clumps of gross palms and the scattering of spikers on the opposite hill. There were more than 70, maybe more than 80 troopers down, dead, wounded, or surrendered, and there were more than 90 blasters scattered about. It was a most gratifying sight.
Lieutenant Pincoat, he said as his second-in-command approached. How many casualties?
Lieutenant Soakum Pincoat showed teeth filed to points when she smiled at him.
Only 6, Commander.
6 fighters dead is nothing to smile about, Lieutenant, he snapped at her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.